There is a secret to make successful superhero adaptations. That secret is the comics. The reason why the MCU, the Spider-Man and X-Men animated series from the 90s are so successful is because they drew inspiration from the source material, adapting some of the best stories from the comics. The same thing happened with Batman the animated series, where many episodes were either inspired or direct adaptations of some of the best Batman stories. The animated series was my guide to approach the old Batman comics, and I think every fan of the show should definitely take a look at every comic book that inspired Batman, the animated series. We are taking a look at the episodes in production order, so we have to start with On Leather Wings, the pilot episode of the show. The story was clearly inspired by the first appearance of Man-Bat from issues 400, 402 and 407 of Detective Comics. The backstory of Kirk Langstrom is pretty much the same, and the final moment with Batman and Man-Bat in the Batcave is almost exactly the same as in the comics. The episode Be a Clown has some similarities with Batman 286. Starting with a cover image of Batman fighting Jokers on a Ferris wheel, the story then takes place almost entirely on an amusement park, where Joker is disguised and, at one point, Batman has to save a child in one of the attractions. The two-part episode Two-Face introduced a different origin story for the classic Batman enemy. Instead of having his face scarred by acid during a trial, this Two-Face is a victim of an unfortunate accident caused by the mobster Rupert Thorne. This origin is quite similar to the story called Two-Face Strikes Again from Batman number 81, where Harvey Dent is scarred by an explosion when he tries to stop some thugs from stealing a save. Now, this was the second time Harvey got his face scarred, and that's why this is not considered the official origin story, but it was clearly an inspiration for his origin in the animated series. The villain of the episode See No Evil is called Lloyd Ventrix, a man who becomes invisible thanks to a special suit. This invisible man seems to have been inspired by the Mirror Man, a villain from Detective Comics 213. While the Mirror Man didn't become invisible, his name was Floyd Ventris, and he used technology to create optical illusions. The final showdown on the episode Prophecy of Doom is reminiscent of the final battle from Batman number 22. In both cases, the fight happens in a planetarium, where planets collide and crash, while Batman fights to stop the criminals. The episode Vendetta is one of the darkest, most sinister episodes of the series, and it features the introduction of Killer Croc. This episode is heavily inspired by the first Killer Croc storyline from 1983. The episode repeats the formula of the comics by making Killer Croc a mysterious figure that lurks in the shadows and hides his real face. In the comics, he impersonates a police officer to infiltrate prison and kill a mobster, while in the episode, he does the same but in order to kidnap a criminal. Batman and Killer Croc fighting in the sewers was taken from Detective Comics 525, and they also included a reference to the writer of all these comics and co-creator of Killer Croc, Jerry Conway, by creating a character called Spider Conway. Speaking of Jerry Conway, he wrote the episode Appointment in Crime Alley, which was inspired by the story There Is No Hope in Crime Alley from Detective Comics 457. The comic was the first appearance of Leslie Thumpkins and Crime Alley, and the episode also introduced both of them to the series, giving them a new popularity and using a very similar story of Batman going back to the place where everything started. The episode Dreams in Darkness is one of the most psychologically charged of the whole series, and it was heavily influenced by The Last Arkham, the first storyline from the Shadow of the Bat comics. In this 1992 story, Batman becomes a prisoner of Arkham Asylum, and he has to find out if one of the inmates is responsible for the crimes happening outside. The main difference between the comic and the episode is that the enemy of the series was the Scarecrow, while the villain of the comics is Mr. Zazz, who was maybe too scary for a kid's show. The comic was published the same year as the episode, showing that the creators of the show were not afraid to look at more recent comics. Another example of this is the episode Perchance to Dream, where Bruce Wayne realizes he is not Batman. This episode was inspired by the story called Identity Crisis from Detective Comics 633, which was published in 1991, just 1 year before the show started. In this comic, Bruce Wayne wakes up in a world where he is not Batman. He has never been Batman. Alfred is only the butler at Wayne Manor, and the Batcave doesn't exist. The episode adapted almost everything about the story, even Bruce escaping from the police and using climbing equipment to confront Batman. The only difference is that the enemy of the episode was the Mad Hatter, while the villain of the comic was a minor character called the Synaptic Kid, who never appeared again. The most faithful adaptation was probably the episode The Cape and Cowl Conspiracy, which was written by Elliot S. Magging. He was a veteran comic book writer who also wrote the original story that this episode adapted, all the way back in 1975. The story was called The Cape and Cowl Death Trap, and was published in Detective Comics 450. Ironically, that story was partially inspired by an episode of the Batman TV show of the 1960s, so basically this is an adaptation of an adaptation. The two-part episode Robin's Reckoning is not exactly an adaptation of a comic, but the origin story of Dick Grayson was taken directly from his first comic book appearance in Detective Comics number 38. This story pretty much established the origin of Dick Grayson, and the episode based much of the plot around this timeless story, written by Bill Finger. The Laughing Fish is one of the best episodes of the series, and it's no surprise, considering it was an adaptation of not one, but four of the greatest Batman comics of all time. The first half of the episode was an adaptation of The Laughing Fish and The Sign of the Joker, both stories from Detective Comics 475 and 476. The second half of the episode was an adaptation of The Joker's Five-Way Revenge from Batman 251. And the final moment of the episode, where Joker apparently dies, was directly adapted from the last panel of Batman 321. All of them are some of the greatest Joker stories ever told. So naturally, this episode was like a love letter to the Clown Prince of Crime. The character design of Kyotai Ken of the episode Night of the Ninja has a striking resemblance to the Thief of Night, a Batman enemy from the early 1980s. Both characters are thieves that wear skin-tight black outfits, and in Batman number 377, the fight happens on a rooftop where Batman is almost defeated until he is saved by Nocturna, almost exactly what happens in the episode, but with Robin. The Strange Secret of Bruce Wayne adapts some of the best stories from the Bronze Age, specifically the stories called The Dead Yet Live and I Am Batman, from Detective Comics 471 and 472. These stories brought back Hugo Strange and made him an important character in the Batman mythos. The whole idea of him discovering the secret identity of Batman and selling it to other villains was taken from these comics. The ending of this episode is also very similar to a story called The Secret of Bruce Wayne, from World's Finest number 6, where a criminal uncovers the secret identity of Batman, but the Dark Knight throws him off when he appears side by side with Bruce Wayne. If You're So Smart, Why Aren't You Rich is the Riddler's debut on the series, and it features many elements from the Riddler's first appearance in the comics. His fascination with puzzles and crosswords, the riddle about corn, the final showdown inside a maze, and the Riddler's escape at the end are all taken from Detective Comics 140, written by Bill Finger in 1948. The Joker's Wild is not exactly an adaptation, but it was likely inspired by the story called Gamble with Doom from Batman number 44. In this story, Joker creates his own casino full of traps for Batman. One of these traps includes a giant roulette, just like the one in this episode. One of the most complete and faithful adaptations is Moon of the Wolf. The episode was written by Len Wein, another legendary comic book writer who actually wrote the original story in 1974. It was published in Batman 255, and the episode is an accurate recreation of this horror story. Speaking of horror stories, the episode Terror in the Sky was inspired by the transformation of Francine Langstrom into the She-Bat from Detective Comics 407, but the general plot of the episode was mostly inspired by the story Man-Bat Over Vegas from Detective Comics 429. The episode Almost Got Him was inspired by more than one classic Batman comic. The whole idea of the bad guys talking about Batman while playing poker and with a twist ending was something that already happened in Detective Comics number 61 back in 1942. Then there's also the image of Batman tied to a giant penny, which first appeared in Batman number 75 and then was used by Two-Face in Batman number 81. The episode What is Reality was inspired by a 1991 trilogy from Detective Comics. In the story, Batman and Robin fight an enemy that creates a virtual world using equipment similar to the machine that Riddler uses in the episode. One of the most touching moments of the series happens in the episode I Am the Night, which was inspired by the story called Look to the Mountaintop from Detective Comics 533. Here, Commissioner Gordon is in a coma at the hospital, and some criminals try to kill him. Bullock and Batman work together, and by the end, Gordon wakes up next to his daughter and says an inspirational phrase, just like in the episode. The first appearance of Talia in the series happens in the episode Off Balance, which was a fairly good adaptation of her first appearance in Detective Comics number 411. The episode captures the kind of exciting adventure from this comic, but the main difference is that the enemy of the comic was Dr. Dark, while in the episode it's Count Vertigo. The character of Sid the Squid from the episode The Man Who Killed Batman is probably a reference to an old gangster called the Squid who had a dream where he killed Batman in Detective Comics 524. A similar thing happens with the Crime Doctor, who was a very obscure villain that first appeared in Detective Comics number 77 back in 1943. The episode Paging the Crime Doctor, however, develops the character greatly and changes him from a criminal to a victim of crime. In the episode Blind as a Bat, Bruce Wayne loses his ability to see, similar to the story called Blind Man's Bluff from Batman number 42. The phrase blind as a bat, as well as the outfit that Bruce Wayne uses when he is blind, are all taken from this 1947 story. Additionally, there is a short visual homage to the cover of Batman 319, with Batman hanging helpless above molten steel. The Demon's Quest is probably the best adaptation in the whole series. This two-part episode was the introduction of Ra's al Ghul, and it adapted the two most important comics from the first storyline, featuring the demon. The first part was an adaptation of Daughter of the Demon, the first appearance of Ra's al Ghul from Batman 232. Denis O'Neil was the writer for both the comic and this episode. The second part was written by Len Wein, and it's a faithful adaptation of The Demon Lives Again, the epic finale of the first Ra's al Ghul saga from Batman 244. The sword fight in the desert with a shirtless Batman is even better on the episode, thanks to that amazing soundtrack by Harvey Cohen. Another adaptation from a Denny O'Neill story was the episode Sideshow, which was based on the story called A Vow from the Grave from Detective Comics 410. This story features the little boy with flippers for hands, and the episode replaced the villain with Killer Croc. The episode A Bullet for Bullock was adapted from Detective Comics number 651. This was one of the most modern adaptations, as this comic was published while the show was already on TV. The episode Trial has a few similarities with the 1977 storyline called Where Were You the Night Batman Was Killed? That story began in Batman 291, where all the major villains gather to determine who killed Batman in a mock-up court. As in the episode, the jury are various members of Arkham Asylum, and the prosecutor is Two-Face. The Terrible Trio were based on the same villains that first appeared in Detective Comics 253, even though the stories are completely different. The episode Riddler's Reform shares some similarities with the story Remarkable Ruse of the Riddler from Batman 171, where the Riddler pretends to have reformed to commit more crimes. The final showdown of the episode Second Chance bears a striking resemblance to the ending of the story called Bad Judgment from Showcase 93 number 8. As in the episode, Batman and Two-Face fight high above ground on a construction site, where Batman tries to talk sense into Harvey. In both the story and the episode, Robin shows up just in time to help Batman, and the Dark Knight saves Two-Face from a fatal fall. And last, there's Bane, the episode that introduced this iconic character to the series. The episode was produced around 1994, and it's the most modern adaptation of the whole series, as it draws inspiration from the Nightfall storyline of 1993. The whole concept of Bane, his confrontation with Killer Croc, his kidnapping of Robin, and his plan to break Batman, were all taken from Nightfall. The main difference is that the episode has a happy ending for Batman. And those are all the comics that inspired Batman the Animated Series. I didn't mention episodes like Joker's Millions and Legends of the Dark Knight, because those are from the new Batman Adventures. Anyways, I hope you found some good comics to read, and most importantly, that you enjoyed this video. As always, you can help me out by sharing the video around, and after 4 years of doing this, I finally made a Patreon, so it would mean a lot if you check it out. You can also find me on Twitter at ZalazarKnight, and here's a video that you might also enjoy. Friends, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.